2001. His writings have also appeared in various publications around the world, including the International Pen, Outlook, and the Times of India. And not just this, in 2002, the Indian version of the international fashion magazine Elle named him among the India's 50 most liked people. Thank you so much for being here.
My name is Tenzin Sudhu. I'm a Tibetan, born and brought up in India. Actually, in one of my writings I've written, I'm more Tibetan, I'm more Indian, except for my chingy Tibetan taste. That's a line from my poetry. I say this because I feel as much Indian as Tibetan. My sensibilities, my aesthetics, my politics, my language, my English, everything is Indian. And I think perhaps this is the success of the interaction between Tibetans and Indians for the past 51 years. And still there are a lot of other challenges. The other day I was going to Baroda, and on the train from Varanasi going to Baroda, I found myself doing what we usually call the waitlisted tickets. And on the sleeper class, but without the seat. So I was sitting with a couple of Indians. All of us didn't have seats, so they were all discussing. So they asked me, it's a long time, long night, so we have to tell each other, like, kahan se. So everybody said their own story, somebody from Bihar, from UP, some Gujarati, and then I was the ordinary, you know, because of my face. So I had to explain the story, my face. So I came back Tibetan. None of them understood what is Tibet. So then, it was risky to say I'm from Himachal, because I'm not really from Himachal. I don't belong there. I live there now, but I don't belong there. In fact, I spent more time in Bombay. You know, I lived in Bombay for 5 years. I cannot say that I'm from Bombay. So then I said, I found an easier thing. I said, main Dalai Lama ka aadmi. Oh, Dalai Lama ji Guruji hai na, pata hai na aapko? Nahin, kisi ko pata nahi hai Dalai Lama. Kisi suna nahi hai Dalai Lama. So in general population, there's a huge disconnect, especially among the educated people. Journalists today, now, when we say Tibetans in exile, we are also including the Tibetans living in abroad, in America, in Canada, Europe, Australia, Taiwan, totally put together, other than India, there are about 15,000 Tibetans in Nepal. Very difficult position today. In fact, I'm sad to see the condition of Nepal. For Nepal to say itself, they are unable to manage their kind of power from within. And then Bhutan, always in the shadow of India, and not able to stand up to make any position when there is that kind of pressure from China. So therefore, Nepal and Bhutan has a population of 5,000 Tibetans. And then Europe, America, Canada, Tibetans, I think they are doing very well. They are not only have the citizenship or green cards in these countries, they are able to take part in the local politics and pressure their Senate, their Congress members to speak for them. And therefore, we actually see in fora like the human rights, environment, economics, these countries are able to present the issue of Tibet because they are able to not only put pressure on their own government but mix with the local population and speak for Tibet. And this Western pressure is amounting to a substantial advocacy for Tibet. And this is
two questions. One about possibility. Any possibility of the struggle turning violent. The Tibetans believe in non-violence not only because of his holiness, but in terms of the struggle, firstly, because of our principal belief in non-violence,
I believe that more or less the struggle will remain nonviolent. But at the same time, I cannot say all, you know, 6 million Tibetans are peaceful and violent. I worried about Tibetan Muslims. Yes, there is this population of Tibetan Muslims. Not only Tibetan Muslims, there are Tibetan Christians. And even within the Buddhist heritage, there are different other people who want to say they are different. For example, there is also, I mean, the most oldest and the oldest practice of religion in the Tibetan community is Huen, which is a shamanistic practice. It is not Buddhist. The shamanistic practice, a huge community of that, they live in Sirmaur, in the eastern part of Himachal, Sirmaur. There's a whole refuge camp. And also Tibetan Christians, some of them in Dehradun, Kalimpong, Darjeeling, Gangtok, there are Tibetan Christians also. At the moment, I think the largely when we articulate the Tibetan problem, we talk about the cause. And the cause, which is mostly kind of characterized by the Buddhist aspect. So therefore, it has actually gone out mostly as the Tibetan struggle, and also because our leader, His Holiness, the Dalai Lama, being not only the Tibetan but also the head of head and respected all over the world as a Buddhist leader. So therefore, it has gone out like this. But then, Tibetan Muslims or Tibetan Christians, they are part of the exile government. Their welfare, health, education, everything is taken care of by the exile government from Dharamshala. And even in Srinagar, where the Tibetan Muslim community is, there is an election happening, and they will also take part in electing our members of parliament, our new prime minister.